You are listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm Pete Lesperance, and I'm Tim. Tonight, we're going to be talking more about the ADL. But first, I'd like to say a few things. Bill is working hard on his computer tonight, and he asked me to help him out with the program, along with Pete. And what we're talking about on the ADL and what we had on the ATF reports, those are available to you folks out there for $10 postpaid. Also, his book, Behold a Pale Horse, for non-members is $18.50 postpaid, members $15.50. Use these for Christmas presents, folks. Get the word out. The book is very interesting. It'll explain a lot of what's happening. So to get your copies of either the book or the ATF and ADL reports, send your checks payable to Annie to the Intelligence Service, P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona. That's Sholo, S-H-O-W-L-O-W, Arizona, 85901. And don't forget, make those checks made out to Annie. Okay, folks, what we're going to start will be the papers on the ADL. And but first, we'll lead in with a little music.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be starting off, Militia of Montana. Militia of Montana, MOM, is among the most visible and the most extreme of such groups in the country. MOM is run in Knoxon, Montana, by the Crockman brothers, John and David, and David's son, Randy, all of whom have been long involved in the white supremacist movement. The Crockmans have been members of the Aryan Nations and the Idaho-based neo-Nazi organization that promotes anti-Semitism. White supremacy and the establishment of the white racist state. John Troxman was a featured speaker at the Aryan Nation Congress in 1990. He has also been an active supporter of Randy Weaver, the white supremacist, who was involved in the shootout with federal authorities. Some members of MOM circulate neo-Nazi publications among themselves. One such book, Seed of a Woman, is a novel dealing with the wild exploits of several young neo-Nazis in contemporary America people by gross stereotypes. Its favorable depiction of Nazi-inspired slaughter and its promotes of Nazi doctrine makes a prescription for violence against Jews, blacks, homosexuals, and others. MOM's 8-page pamphlet, The Militia, discusses the history of militias and their origin in the United States, arguing that the Second Amendment was intended to allow citizens to form unorganized militias in order to protect themselves from a potentially tyrannical government. It outlines the militia roles as follows. To balance the power of the nation with the might of the militia will put at odds any scheme by government officials to use force of the government against the people. Therefore, when the codes and statutes are unjust for the majority of the people will rightly revolt and the government will have no quits without a shot being fired. Because the militia stands vigilant in carrying out the will of the people in defense of its rights, liberty, and freedom. The purpose of government is in the protection of the rights of the people. When it does not accomplish this, the militia is the crusader who steps forward, and upon it rests the mantle of rights of the people. Displaying the group's attitude towards taking up arms, John Troxman recently said, "We don't want bloodshed. We want to use the ballot box and the jury box. We don't want to go to the cartridge box. But we will if we have to." MOM's newsletter, Taking Aim, details the ways the government is currently failing to protect the rights of people. It cites gun control and the crime bill as evidence of this, but also suggests a variety of conspiracy theories about plans by world leaders to implement a world government. MOM plays to paranoid fears by making wild claims about supposed activity of foreign military troops in Montana and across the country. One report on the activity of out-of-state troops brought in to fight forest fires concludes, "One more note, mysterious deaths have been taking place since these troops appeared. Coincidence? We do not know." While the newsletter does not echo the racist ideology of Trockman's, it makes a hemispheric slur in alluding to rumors regarding Attorney General Janet Reno's sexual orientation. MOM advertises and distributes books, tapes, and videos that provide further information on their conspiracy theories. Typical of the selection is a video advertised as the Countdown to History, Biochip, Mark of the Beast, UN Police Force, One World Government, Chip Implants, all by the year 2000, totally documented. Also offered are tapes and videos on organizing militia and on survival and combat techniques. MJ Beckman, Red Beckman, an influential figure in the militia movement, has a record as an anti-Semite and anti-tax activist. He recently lost a long struggle with the IRS when he was finally evicted from his land after a long after it had long been sold to pay for taxes due the government. Beckman, like many militia proponents, is a conspiracy theorist. He said that the Federal Reserve Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the so-called New World Order are conspiring to dominate the world. In his 1984 book, The Church Deceived, Beckman proclaimed that the Holocaust was a judgment upon the Jews for worshiping Satan. More recently, he appeared on KULR-TV, a Montana television station, and repeated his views that Jews are worshipers of Satan. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll have to bear with me in reading these papers tonight. New Hampshire law provides for an unorganized militia made up of all citizens over the age of 18 who are not in the National Guard or State Guard. Militia enthusiasts in New Hampshire have pointed out the state's legislature, as well as the Second Amendment to the United States Constitution, to explain and justify their seemingly oxymoric organization of unorganized militias. There is nothing to suggest, however, that they actually intend to serve according to the spirit of the laws by which they justly justify their own existence. Such laws called for a governor of the state to direct members of the unorganized militia to serve in the National Guard during time of crisis. New Hampshire is the home of the Constitution Defense Militia, a well-organized group with at least 15 members. It is not known if the group engages in paramilitary training or the stockpiling of weapons. The group has held meetings at the home of Edward L. Brown of Plainsfield. Brown is outspoken and is in support of the concept of militias and devotes much of his time and energy to the causes embraced by them: opposition to gun control, the United Nations, and federal government. He recently lobbied against a bill that would ban guns in school zones, for example. While much of Brown's activity appears to mainstream opponents of gun control and big government, his enthusiasm for conspiracy theories and his reliance on extremist propaganda places him on the far reaches of the political spectrum. Brown is the devoted reader of the Spotlight, the organ of the Liberty Lobby, and the best-funded and the most active anti-Semite propaganda organization in the United States. In a recent telephone call to the ADL, Brown acknowledged that he gets his information on domestic and international affairs from the Spotlight. He recently wrote letters to his congressmen and senators in Washington regarding the alleged buildup of hostile foreign troops inside the United States. Other members of his militia reportedly also embrace conspiracy fantasies involving the Council of Foreign Relations and the Trilateral Commission and the Rockefeller Foundation. At a recent meeting of the group, members expressed their admiration for two extremist figures, Bo Gryce and Linda Thompson. The group has been in contact with Gryce regarding the organization of militias. As in neighboring Arizona, the organization of militias in New Mexico is in nascent stages. Thus far, the most visible manifestation of pro-military sentiment in Mexico has been found in the Free American, a monthly newspaper published privately by Clayton R. Douglas and his wife Jan Douglas. The September 94 issue contained an advertisement declaring, quote, "It's time to take matters in our own hands. It's time to protect our Constitution. Join the New Mexico Unorganized Militia." The accompanying phone number for more information was the number of the newspaper itself. The militia movement appears to be taking hold in Catherine County, an area in recent years has experienced much anti-federal government sentiment among its residents. Among the groups attempting to organize a local militia are the Concerned Citizens and the Patriots of Catherine County. Finally, literature from Linda Thompson's Unorganized Militia of the United States has been distributed through gun shops in Albuquerque, North Carolina. North Carolina militia movement has been fueled by alarmist version of the U.S. government bent on the destruction of American liberties. a Monroe-based group called the Citizens for the Reinstatement of the Constitutional Government has consolidated around Albert Esposito. He denies that he is preaching revolution, but his rhetoric includes clear overtones for preparations for battle with the imagined enemy. He urges the groups to amass caches of the four Bs, Bibles, bullets, beans, and bandages. Many members own semi-automatic weapons, including AR-15s and AK-47s. The group's program is a mixture of anti-government, religious, and conspiratorial ideas. It aims to take the Holy Bible and the United States Constitution, the law of the land, and it vows to resist the coming of the New World Order, One World Government. To accomplish its goals, it promises to remove treasonous politicians and corrupt judges from positions of authority and return authority to the people. Precisely how these are not to be removed from office is stated. Citizens for the Reinstatement of the Constitutional Government meets twice a month, alternating between Monroe and Union County and Matthews in neighboring Mecklenburg County. At one meeting, Esposito, a 43-year-old contractor, repeatedly reported G. Gordon Liddy's alleged statement about the new crime law's assault weapon ban. He said, "If they pass it, don't obey it. And if they come after you, meet force with force." The group has distributed application forms for the National Free and Sovereign Civilian Militia, North Carolina State Division. The form asks applicants whether they are proficient in the operation of handguns and rifles, reloading ammo, and a variety of survivalist skills. Esposito has espoused his views on guns in Union County Commissioner meetings. He also rallied against the federal encroachment in announcing his support of the non-binding resolution passed by the commission in support of school prayer. Holding a copy of the Constitution in the air, he declared, "We control the county, not Washington." Consistent with such anti-federal government views, Esposito says he has refused to file federal income tax returns for 3 years running because he regards the tax as unconstitutional. The group he leads split off from the tax protest group in Charlotte called the Carolina Patriots, three whose members were convicted in October of 94 of conspiracy to help people avoid their tax obligation. Esposito's group has attempted to distance itself from the Carolina Patriots. In addition to their views on guns and taxes, members of the Monroe group have expressed ideas and conspiracy theories that are characteristics of some of the militias around the country. These include charges that the Federal Reserve System has enriched a tiny elite. Group's literature advocates the abolition of the Federal Reserve, and that some government employees have been implanted with computer chips in order to monitor citizenry. Another claim made by one of the group's meetings is that the government cannot require private citizens to obtain a driver's license. Echoes the stand of an early extremist group, Posse Comitatus. Excuse me. I'm getting a little bit dry there. A separate North Carolina militia group has been formed in Greenville, in the eastern part of the state. Led by Scott Brown, the unit is part of the Idaho-based United States Militia Association. Brown reportedly has said his group worries that the government representatives don't really understand what the Constitution means and stands for. They are voting anyway for our unalienable rights. It is not known whether the Greenville unit is engaging in any more incendiary rhetoric or activity, but this fear, which has apparently spreading and growing, that the government is a threat to the rights of the people. It is a central theme that militia groups are feverishly trying to exploit. A computer bulletin board in Almanis County called the Spirit of 76 has served as an area recruiting point for the militia led by Linda Thompson, the Indianapolis woman who is leading who is a leading figure in the militia movement nationwide. Another bulletin board system made Thompson's computerized materials available as referred individuals interested in joining the militia to the Spirit of 76. For its part, the Spirit of 76 has declared itself off limits to police and government authorities by posting a warning that states, "This BS bulletin is a private system. Only private citizens are not involved in government or law enforcement activities are authorized to use it." Ohio. Several militia-like groups have arisen in scattered counties in the state of Ohio. One such militia has been meeting and conducting paramilitary training exercises in Pike County in rural South Central Ohio. This is overlapping precipitation in weapon sales connection with among Pike County militia, the neo-Nazi SS action group of the Ku Klux Klan. Other militia groups have arisen in Franklin County and Warren County. A militia-type group called Patriots meets in Cincinnati and conducts paramilitary exercises in rural Claremont County. Virginia. On July 27th of this year, James Roy Mullins, a founder and member of the militia-like group called the Blue Ridge Hunt Club, was arrested and charged for the possession and sale of a short-barreled rifle and unregistered silencers with unlawful purchase of firearm. Ultimately, three members were also charged with firearm offenses. Federal officials said that Mullins had formed a club to arm his members in precipitation of the war on the government. The cases are pending. The group formed earlier in 94 has had only 15 members. They are said to have met three times before Mullen was arrested. While members of the group say their purpose is to lobby against gun control laws, the federal enforcement officials tell much different stories. An ATF official who investigated the case said that Mullins is organizing a group of Confederates to be armed and trained in paramilitary fashion in preparation for armed conflict with the government authorities should firearms legislation be too restrictive. Evidence of such preparation is substantial. In searches of members of homes and storage facilities, federal agents found stockpiles of weapons. In Mullins' home, agents found 13 guns, several of which had homemade silencers. They also found explosives, hand grenades, fuses, blasting caps in separate warehouses. While in jail, he wrote a letter to a friend saying he wanted to borrow a machine gun in order to take care of some unfinished business with certain prosecution witnesses. The strongest indication of the group's goals was the draft of a portion of a newsletter found in a computer disk obtained by federal agents. On the disk, Mullins had written, "Hit and run tactics will be a method of fighting. We will destroy targets such as telephone relay centers, bridges, fuel storage tanks, communication towers, radio stations, airports, and so on. Human targets will be engaged. When it is beneficial to take cause to eliminate particular individuals who oppose us," meaning troops, police, political figures, snitches, and so on. An ATF official also said that Mullins was planning to arm a group by burglarizing the National Guard Armory in Pulaski, Virginia. Conclusion. Given the revolutionary posturing of so many militias, and the role in them of long-standing, the better part of wisdom dictates that the close attention to be paid to them. There is a role here for the press and the citizen organizations to monitor extreme. Anti-Defamation League is pledged to do its part. The chief responsibility for keeping on top of the militia threat, however, plainly rests with law enforcement branch of the government. That is, the responsibility must be implemented with all due respect for legal rights to which everyone is entitled should they go without saying. Law enforcement agencies need to requisite resources to monitor these groups and to take appropriate measures when necessary to protect the public. One such tool is paramilitary training legislation already on the books in many states. Those laws, many patterned after the model bill first formulated by the ADL, which is appended to this report, should be applied where appropriate. In the states where such laws have yet to be appropriated, ADL urges that they be given prompt consideration. The right to hold and promote one's views on the issues which are aggregating the militias, such as gun control, the environment, and abortion, is inviolate under the Constitution. There is no right, however, to use force or violence, either to impose one's views or others to resist laws properly enacted. That is the crux of the problem presented by the rise of the militias. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you want to listen real carefully to this. The appendix, ADL model paramilitary training statute. A. 1. Whoever teaches or demonstrates to any other person the use, application, or making of any firearm, explosive, incendiary device, or technique capable of causing injury or death to persons, knowingly or having reason to know, intending that the same will be unlawfully employed in the use or furtherance of civil disorder, or 2. Whoever assembles with one or more persons for the purpose of training, with practicing, being instructed the use of any firearm, explosive, or incendiary device, or a technique capable of causing injury or death to persons, intending to employ unlawfully the same for use in the furtherance of civil disorder, shall be fined not more than blank, or imprisoned for not more than blank, years or both. B. Nothing contained in this section shall make it unlawful for any act of law enforcement officer which is performed in the lawful presence of his official duties. Let me read that again. B. Nothing contained in this section shall make unlawful any act of any law enforcement officer which is performed in any lawful performance of his duties. C. As used in this section. 1. The term civil disorder means a public disturbance involving acts of violence by assemblages of three or more persons, which causes an immediate danger of a results in damage of injury and property of persons of any other individual. 2. The term firearms means any weapon designed or any readily converted to expel a projectile by the action of an explosive or the frame or receiver of any such weapon. 3. The term explosive or incendiary device means A. dynamite and all other forms of high explosives. B. any explosive bomb, grenade, missile, or similar device. And C. any incendiary bomb or grenade, firebomb, or similar device, including a device which consists of and includes breakable container, including a flammable liquid or compound.
This ain't coming from the prophet. Just an ordinary man. When I close my eyes, I see the way this world shall be. We all came in it. When the last child cries for a crust of bread, when the last man dies for his words that he said, when there's shelter over the poor face, we shall be free. We laugh
thing we notice is the color of skin. And the first thing we look for is the beauty within. When the skies and the oceans are green with gaze, we shall be free. We shall be free. We give you love, anyone we need. We shall be free. Have a little faith, hold on. We shall be free.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's a lot of things we have to do in the future, and a lot of things we have to do right now. Some of the things we have to do is get prepared for what's coming. There's many ways of getting prepared. Getting prepared by getting food, clothing, things of this nature. And there's always one thing that's very useful in times to come, and always retained its value, and that's precious metals in its various forms. And through Swiss America, which I have dealt with personally, it's helped me very much in trying to accomplish a goal that I've set for myself to acquire some precious metals, because the Federal Reserve notes, as we know them, are going to be worthless. Gold and silver and other precious metals will always retain their value. Swiss America is doing a great job for us people who really want to look ahead to the future and be prepared. Swiss America, and you can call for information, is 1-800-BUY-COIN or 1-800-289-2646. Swiss America has sponsored this program and has been with Bill for quite some time through the hard times and all, and they've stuck with Bill and this program, so we need to stick with them and really do a thing with Swiss America. In other words, they can help you prepare a portfolio that you'll need in the coming events. And if you have questions, just give them a call. They'll be glad to help you. They have a lot of answers, and they don't mind how many questions you give them. They'll try and find an answer for you. Craig Smith and Gene Miller, who I know, have done a fine job with others that I have recommended to Swiss America, and they've helped me out quite a bit in understanding the metals market and things that are coming, and has given me quite a bit of knowledge. So if you need some answers to questions that you might have, don't procrastinate. Call Swiss America at 1-800-289-2646. So do it now, folks. Don't procrastinate like a lot of us do. And myself, I've held off when I first started to call for some time. And one day I just called them, and they were very congenial over the phone and answered many questions before I bought my first coin. So myself, I don't have any problem with them. They've been honest with me and been honest with others that they have helped, that are friends of mine. So I feel real comfortable with Swiss America. So don't forget, folks, call Swiss America, 1-800-BUY-COIN, 1-800-289-2646, and do it now.
Hold me now.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to be reading the appendix over again for you, for those of you that didn't catch it. Appendix, ADL Model Paramilitary Training Statute. A. 1. Whoever teaches or demonstrates to any other person the use, application, or making of a firearm, explosive or incendiary device, or a technique capable of causing injury or death to persons, knowing or having reason to know or intending that the same will be unlawfully employed for the use in the furtherance of a civil disorder, or, number 2, whoever assembles with one or more persons for the purpose of training with, practicing with, or being instructed in any use of firearm, explosive or incendiary device, or technique capable of causing injury or death to persons intending to employ unlawfully the same for use in the furtherance of civil disorder, shall be fined not more than blank, or imprisoned for not more than blank years, or both. B. Nothing contained in this section shall make unlawful act any law enforcement officer which is performed in the lawful performance of his official duties. C. As used in this section, 1. The term civil disorder means any public disturbance involving acts of violence or assemblages of three or more persons which causes an immediate danger of or results in damage of property, injury of a person, or any other individual. 2. The term firearm means any weapon which is designed to or readily be converted to expel any projectile by the action of an explosive or the frame or receiver of any such weapon. 3. The term explosive or incendiary device means A. dynamite and all other forms of high explosives. B. any explosive bomb, grenade, missile, or similar device. C. any incendiary bomb or grenade, firebomb, or similar device, including any device which consists of or includes a breakable container, including a flammable liquid or compound, and in a wick composed of any material which is ignited, is capable of igniting such flammable liquid or compound. and can be carried or thrown by one individual acting alone. 4. The term law enforcement officer means any officer or employee of the United States, any state, any political subdivision of a state, or the District of Columbia, and such term shall specifically include, but shall not be limited to, members of the National Guard, as defined in Section 101(9) of Title 10, the United States Code, members of the organized militia of any state or territory of the United States, the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, or the District of Columbia, not included within the definition of the National Guard as defined by such Section 101, Paragraph 9, and members of the Armed Forces of the United States. Also, ladies and gentlemen, on the last sheet, the ADL has 31 offices within the United States in the different counties, which I won't read, in the different states and counties, and 2 offices overseas, Jerusalem and Canada. Now, if you want copies of this, send $10 to the Intelligence Service, P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. Include $10, or make your checks payable to Annie, and we will send you in return mail the copies of the ATF report and the ADL report, which Bill heard earlier on earlier programs. Also remember that Behold a Pale Horse for non-members is $18.50, and members are $15.50. And don't forget, it goes to Intelligence Service, P.O. Box 1420, Sholow, Sholow, Arizona, 85901. Well, there we have it. I hope you folks bared with me on reading of this, but these were important papers that Bill wanted to finish the program out with, and other things that you have to get prepared with, folks, is the time of the year. It is getting cold, and we're going to have snow, so I would check into warm clothing, boots, snowshoes, things of this nature. Go to the local big stores that might have sales on clothing. Don't forget the little kids. We have to keep them warm, too. There's different types of equipment out there, and also, if you wanted, you can send me $2 for our catalog for surplus and stuff, preparedness equipment and supplies, and the address for that would be Surplus and Stuff, P.O. Box 3300, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. That's Surplus and Stuff, P.O. Box 3300, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. And don't forget to include $2, and we'll send you back a catalog in return mail. Things that we have are a lot of camping equipment, some survival equipment is in there, medical equipment, things of this nature. There's also different types of books that we have on survival and different techniques. If you have any questions, folks, you also can call me during the daytime, Arizona time, which would be 9 a.m. till 6 p.m., and you can call me at 602-337-2975. That's area code 602-337-2975, and I'll be happy to help you in any requests you might have or questions regarding the catalog and equipment. We're here to try and help you. Also, I'd like you to invite you to visit the Research Center here in Arizona in St. John's on Commercial Street. There's a lot of things to see and to read here in the Research Center. We're getting books sent to us all the time from different people. A lot of it is real educational, and after 51 years myself, I'm sitting down starting to read, because there's a lot of information contained in this library that Bill is putting together, along with help of you folks out there sending us books to give us more knowledge. So we really appreciate the things that you do in the support of the library. And those of you who have dropped by the Research Center, we've done a little bit more probably since you've been here. So we're just trying to get along with what we can do. Don't forget the different types of food storage that is out there that we'll need in the coming times. If you have any questions on that, you can call the Research Center at 602-337-2562. That's 337-2562, area code 602. And we'll be happy to send you some information. Send us a number 10 size envelope, and we can send you information on that. Also, there's the food storage information is in the catalog with surplus and stuff. And it gives you different varieties and different size packages of foods that you can purchase. Don't forget, read up on drinking water. There's a lot of systems out there that you can buy to purify water. Bleach, if you want to store water, you can put so many drops of bleach per gallon of water, and you'll be able to store it that way, and you won't have any fungus growing in it, and it'll help keep it fresh for later on. Water is one of the main things that you'll be needing when you're out. If you have to go to the field for any reason, if they shut water off in the cities, the same thing. You can use some Clorox bleach or any brand of bleach to help you sustain your water supply. Also, there's different types of water tablets out there for smaller quantities, and water filter straws. There's water purification systems such as the Katadyn water system. And any of you wanting information on that, just let me know on surplus and stuff, and I'll mail you out a little pamphlet I have from Katadyn. And we've tried it, and it is a good system, and it does purify the water without the use of any chemicals, which I'm happy to say, because too many chemicals, iodine or chlorine, will eventually hurt your system in different ways. So, let's see here. Excuse me a minute. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. I wanted to reach over and pick up a couple of items that I thought might be of interest to you. In the catalog that we have a list of things that you should be stocking up on or getting prepared with, and I'll read it as soon as I get to that page. Okay, here we have it. Emergency supply list. You have to bear with me tonight, folks. I didn't have everything in line like I should have, so here it goes. Safety and comfort. You want to have some sturdy shoes, heavy work gloves, hat or cap for weather protection, whether it's cold or sun, because you got to remember that your top of your head emits a lot of heat out of your system. One full change of sturdy clothing, a tent or tarpaulin to make a shelter or cover, candles, waterproof matches, fire starter, heavy-duty type knife, rain suit or large poncho, rubber boots or overshoes, an extra pair of glasses if required, cooking and food and care. Portable cooking stove, potable water tablets, extra fuel for cooking stove, heavy-duty aluminum foil, full mess kit for each person, at least two cooking pots, one lightweight water kettle, cooking utensils, knives, forks, spoons, or spatula, paper towels, cooking mitts, napkins, hot pad, fry pan or two, two medium-sized plastic wash tubs, 2 weeks' supply of paper plates and plastic knife, forks, or spoons, and cooking oil, something that won't spoil easy. Cottonseed oil, corn oil, things of that nature are a lot better than an animal-type based cooking oil. Sanitation supplies. You want to have a porta-potty, toilet paper, at least one roll each person. If infant supplies, don't forget a supply of diapers, baby powder, baby oil, things of this nature for the little ones. Large trash bags for sealing trash. Soap, you want to have soap for dishes and for hand. Disinfectant powder or liquid. Pre-moistened towelettes. Two plastic 5-gallon buckets, one for trash and one to make a porta potty out of. Large bath towel and hand towel, toothbrushes and mouthwash, shampoo and toothpaste, Ziploc bags for storage, scrubber brush, a pad for dishes, one or two plastic wash tubs, tools and miscellaneous items, axe, shovel, broom, dustpan, handsaw, hammer, nails, pry bar, screwdrivers, two adjustable wrenches, large and medium, one pair of channel locks or vice grips, 100 feet of 1/4 inch or 3/8 inch rope, a roll of duct tape, camp lantern and extra fuel, cards and travel games to help pass the time, some form of identification, money or items that can be traded, survival, water, 1 gallon, a full first aid kit with book, food, lightweight, high nutritional, can opener, manual type, radio, portable with extra battery, and that radio should have the capabilities of shortwave radio. Don't forget that, folks. Flashlight with extra battery and bulb, essential medication for people that have heart problems, diabetic, and so on. An ABC type fire extinguisher, watch or clock, battery or wind up. Food for your pets if you have any pets with you. Space blankets, sleeping bags, ground cloth. Salt tablets and vitamin supplements. For car travel and a mini survival kit. Bottled water, first aid kit with book, non-perishable food, space blanket, lightweight sleeping bag or bedroll, rain suit or poncho, sturdy shoes, sunglasses and goggles. One change of clothes, small package of pre-moistened towelettes, hat, glove, coat, and sweater, flashlight and battery. Don't forget extra bulbs, folks. A simple tool set, road flares, local maps of the area, hammer, pry bar, and knife. Now, the car travel mini survival kit, a lot of us up here in the mountains and hunters and campers that travel these mountains, we carry these items with us. Myself, in the past 20-some-odd years of being up here, I've ran into several people that just came up into the mountains for a drive and wound up getting in a snowstorm or breaking down in a hot summer and driving out on some of these deserted roads and didn't have any of these items with them, and they wish they would have. So that's just a list of some emergency supplies. It's more or less a guide of some of the things that you should have. You can make up your own list, and you can extend this list a lot further. So, if we can be any help, just give us a call at 602-337-2975. And
that'll be all I have tonight, folks, and I thank you very much. And God bless you all, and God save the Republic. Thank you.
Tomorrow all the things were gone, worked for all my life, and I had to start again, with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, but the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. Shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston.